So things escalate quickly in this episode, and what a masterful, wonderfully laid out plan this was. And man, this just gets better and better.
Hunter, Hunter, episode 57, Initiative and Law.
Oh, I can't believe that. Are you kidding me? Well, hello, my brothers and sisters and hunters and phantom troop members of the Nerd Nation. I, as always, am Jim, here to bring you another review on the awesome and just, oh my God, thought-provoking, just wonderfully written, wonderfully realized, and animated tale of Hunter Hunter. Our last episode, of course, really saw us with the bottom line being Gon and Killua having been captured by the troop. And then, of course, Squalla wound up getting his head cut off at the end by Nobunaga after Pakunoto had, you know, read his mind. And they now kind of have a clear picture of who Kurapika is, the chain user, and what he looks like. So that's how things left off. Things pick up over here, and they escalate very, very quickly. Those six troop members get back together, wind up meeting up with each other. The Nobunaga, Pekunodu, and Kurtopi, as well as Krollo, Machi, and Shizuku. And of course, they have Gon and Killua captured, and they wind up going to the actual hotel that they were originally going to go to, right? Melody is able to hear, because she can hear these conversations from, you know, seemingly miles away, but blocks away or whatever, where they're going, where they're on to, because they were following and listening in, right? So as they walk into the hotel, they notice almost immediately, and Machi's got her little thread thing that's binding Killua and Gon's hands behind their back, right? So as they're all there in the hotel and, you know, obviously keeping an eye on the door for anybody that comes in, we see Leorio, who winds up going and making a big stink about this conversation on the phone, but what he's really trying to do is tip Gon and Killua off to the plan, right? And that it better be here at 7 o'clock, and it's like 3 minutes to 7, right? So Gon and Killua, they know some shit's going to go down, right? And they're thinking that, okay, it's going to go down. They're going to obviously, you know, the lights are going to go out. And you know what, tell you the truth, that part I didn't pick up on how they figured the lights were going to go down. I don't know if it was a combination of what Leorio said, and then they were listening to the radio DJ that wound up starting to play the Hunter Hunter opening song. And anyway, right, they know that they've got to kind of stall out for about 3 minutes over here. And the Phantom Troop members are talking amongst themselves about what are they going to do, what are they going to do with these kids, blah, 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 right? And so as the other three wind up getting back to meet them, Nobunaga and Pekunoto and Kurtopi, we wind up getting, you know, Pekunoto wants to go and explain how the chain user looks and all the stuff that they got from the memories, right? Krollo's like, yeah, but first check the boys again, right? You know, check them to see what they're, I want to know what they're hiding. So now there's only like a minute left, and Gon and Killua have to go and buy some time. Prior to that, Nobunaga comes up to him and says, oh, you guys came back, you want to join, huh? And then Killua's like, no, we don't ever want to be your friend. We don't even want to look at your face. And they use that as an excuse to close their eyes so their eyes can start to get adjusted to the dark. Obviously, it takes a minute or two, you know? And it's awesome because when Killua gets the signal on that 7 o'clock thing, he's like, all right, I can go and break free from these bindings by going and dislocating my fingers and then go and pull out, and that'll take me 0.7 seconds, and that'll be more than enough time to execute an attack under cover of darkness while their eyes are still adjusting. All just laid out so beautifully, man. It's like a wonderful chess game. Oh, I love it. So anyway, as things wind up coming to a head, Pekunoda comes over and is going to go to kind of read their minds, and Killua's got to buy some time, you know, so he's just like, you know what, you can't read our minds. First of all, we're innocent, and the way your power works is that you have to go and bring memories up from, and then Gon's like, yeah, we'll just think of something else. So she goes and grabs Killua by his head, and then grabs Gon by his head and picks him up. She's a strong bitch, right? And as sexy as she is in this little, like, skimpy, sort of, like, hot businesswoman outfit, you know, she's wearing, like, flats instead of heels, and then she's just got that just witch's nose, man. Oh, I don't know what's going on. Oh, terrible. But anyway, so she's just like, that's not how my power works. And it's really cool because they explain to the audience here how her power works. And it's actually like your memories when she goes, and she can kind of like, it's like kicking dirt up, and that's into the wind. She just catches it all, and that's all the memories and everything that's laid out, you know, and that she can actually see more of your memories and your mind than you can, because you forget things and whatnot. Things slip out, you put things off to the side. So very, very cool. But we wind up having, and the shit goes down quickly, right? All of a sudden it hits 7 o'clock, you know? And this is right as she's reading their mind and she's getting the information that they know the chain user and that they did the whole time and everything else. But man, is it great. the lights go down, right? The lights go down, and then Killua goes and goes, and winds up dislocating his fingers, you know? Pulls his hands free from Machi's grasp, whatever, relocates the things. He goes and he busts Pakunoda, winds up just breaking her left arm, right? And then Gon goes and he's like, BAM! Kicks the bitch in the face, and she's going back. So then Machi goes and winds up loosing, you know, her threads or whatever on Gon, and then goes to try to go for Killua. Killua goes to try to save Gon and goes and comes in with his cool claw-handed technique. Boom! Right into Machi, and he's like, I'm gonna have to kill her, you know? And I'm thinking, oh shit, he's gonna take one of them down now under cover of darkness. And remember, this is all in like a few seconds while their eyes are adjusting to the dark. He's able to get in there, but he can't remove his hand because her muscles are too strong, and obviously she knew the attack was coming or was able to, probably still took damage, but he wasn't able to actually just straight up be like, and just gutter, you know, like he wanted to. Nobunaga goes and busts out his aura and shit and makes his end cloud go out and everything, so now he can obviously feel anything that comes into that cloud. He winds up going and grabbing Gon by the feet, and he's like, yeah, nice attempt, but you two are done, right? So the lights go and wind up, well, the lights come back on a couple minutes later or a minute later, but their eyes are adjusting and everything else. But the great thing about this whole scene is as everything plays out and they're just like, okay, now they still got Gon and Killua, a sword or a knife comes flying in and Nobunaga dodges it and it hits into the wall, right? All of a sudden, as the lights go back on, somebody mentions, they're like, well, where the hell's the boss? And while under cover of darkness, Kurapika, along with Melody and Leorio, this wonderful plan that they laid out, somehow were able to capture Krollo, right? And take the boss and get him the fuck out of Dodge, man. Wow! I was just like, are you kidding? So anyway, Nobunaga goes over and grabs the dagger out of the wall, and there was a note attached to it, and the note, he gives it to Pakunoda, and it says, if you talk about the kids, your hostages' memories, I'll kill your boss, right? So Pakunoda just has to shut up right then and there. And she goes through this whole thing in her mind, and it's actually really cool because she goes and breaks down everything in her mind, and it takes us back to her initial initiation into the troop, or when the troop was formed. And it looks like it's in Meteor City because there's just like these ruins and desolation all around them, and everybody looks different and younger. But the Phantom Troop, the whole idea of it is that a spider can function even when its head's been cut off, right? Or when its head's been removed, and that's how it's explained. So what Krollo tries to instill in everybody is that we have rules and laws, those are absolute. If I am killed, somebody else can take my place. The spider functions as the sum of all its parts, as opposed to just any one person. There's no one person that's above the rest, you know? So Pakunoda has this real great sort of like vision, flashback sort of thing, and she's thinking, the thing that Krollo would want me to do is not to hold him above everybody else, and basically to just say, fuck that. Let's go and take, well, we'll kill these kids, whatever we got to do. And then ultimately, if the chain user does wind up, if Kurapika winds up killing Krollo, hey, too bad, one of us will replace him. The bottom line is we don't want to betray the spider. That's what it is. We don't want to betray the spider. And then we can, and then of course, Kurapika has, you know, has no leverage, no advantage. There's still 10 of them left, right? Or 11 of them. So anyway, I don't count Hisoka because he's actually like a turncoat, right? So this shit just gets good because, man, it had my heart going like this in the first few minutes, you know? And then it kind of does. It slows down a little bit. It dies down. It shows us the car as they're driving away, and you've got Leorio and Melody in the front seat. You've got Kurapika with the chain jail, chains of justice, as I like to call them, wrapped around Krollo. And Krollo, man, he is just smooth as the other side of the pillow. He didn't see none of this shit in the fortune, so he basically is just calm and level, and he's just like, you know what? This is like an afternoon tea for me, right? There's obviously nothing that's going to come of it because he didn't see it in the fortune, you know? What he's not looking into is the future of the fortune, which is Hisoka facing off against him and everything else, but I think what he's looking at is right now. This part wasn't foretold, right? So it can't be significant, is his thought. And he's really just trying to go and to pull out from Kurapika and see if he has any weaknesses, you know? And it's funny because he's just like, oh, I didn't expect you to be a woman. And Kurapika's like, oh, looks can be deceiving, and pulls off the wig, you know? And I'm like, Kurapika still sounds like a woman and kind of looks like one anyway, but that's just me, I guess. So Melody goes and is actually scared of how calm and eerie his heartbeat is, because he straight up believes he has no value as a hostage, because he knows what he's instilled. The rules and the laws of the spider are absolute. He knows that if they follow what he's laid out for them, that he should just be given up anyway. Nobody should care. He's the boss, but hey, somebody will replace him. And Melody, actually, between Kurapika and his just sort of crazy bloodlust heartbeat, and Krollo and his just deadpan, like, just sort of heartless monster that he is, you know, Melody's like, I don't want to listen to it anymore, you know? But I just thought it was great. You know, Kurapika's trying to go and question Krollo. Krollo is like, I'm not going to answer any of your questions. You know, I bet you Uvo didn't answer him either. You know, I have no desire to talk to you, right? But what he winds up finding out is that Kurapika has a weakness. Kurapika does want to go and see the hostages survive, you know? So Kurapika winds up calling from Krollo's phone. I bet you he's got all the Phantom Troop members on speed dial. He's got them in his friends and family, or maybe his family plan through AT&T. I don't know. But anyway, winds up dialing up and calling up, because now at this point, a few more of the members have arrived. Finks and Shalnark, I think. Anyway, a few more of them wind up arriving, so there's 7, 8, 9 of them there now. And they're talking amongst themselves about what they should do. But Finks winds up getting the call. I believe it's Finks. And gets the call. And first he tries to go and Kurapika's trying to take control and assert control in a hostage situation. I want three things. First, you don't follow me. Second, you don't hurt the hostages. And third, you put Pekinoda on the phone, I think is what he said. Yeah, you put her on the phone. Anyway, he goes, well, about the second thing, they tried to escape and we had to break a few bones, right? And Kurapika's like, then we have nothing to talk about. Just hangs up. So Finks calls back right away. He's like, no, I was actually lying, you know? And Kurapika's like, yeah, don't do shit like that, right? It's going to get your boss killed, you dumb fuck. So anyway, he winds up putting Pekinoda on the phone, and Pekinoda has to go and walk away from everybody else, and she is told to go, and she's going to meet them at this place at 8 o'clock, and that's where she's going to meet. She's to come alone, and she's not to talk or look or glance or give any tip-offs to the rest of the troop members, but they are to go back to their hideout, and they're going to wait, right? And if he senses anything is wrong, I keep referring to Kurapika as a she sometimes, then he's obviously the boss is going to be killed, right? So Pekinoda goes and winds up giving the phone then to Nobunaga, and he kind of gets the rundown of how they got to go back to their hideout and everything else. They all sit around discuss. She takes off. She walks out, right? And they're all like, Finks is basically like the ringleader of the ones for like, hey, listen, you know, the spider has to function and has to go on. You cannot shame the spider. Nobunaga's like, we all got to go back to the hideout and do what he said, at least for right now. So these two are going at it fighting, and you got, you know, a lot of people are on Finks's side, but Shizuku winds up being actually on Nobunaga's side. Regardless of how it works out, they wind up calling back. Kurapika does a few minutes later and asks to put one of the hostages on the phone. When Killua gets on the phone, he goes and says, is everybody still there? And Killua says, yeah, for now, but they're talking about following Pekinoda, right? This was all devised in just a wonderfully intricate way so they could know without a doubt that Pekinoda was not being followed and have it gotten far enough away, you know, at least in my mind, that's how I picture it. But what winds up happening after they hang up the phone is, you know, they got 30 minutes to get back to the hideout, and Nobunaga and Finks are still fighting about it. It actually gets to the point where Nobunaga goes and just busts out his aura, pulls out his sword, and he's like, you make another step, and I'm going to cut you down. And then Finks goes and pulls his aura, and he's like, go ahead and try it, motherfucker, you know? Anyway, Shizuku winds up going and knocking Nobunaga unconscious, you know, with her little magic vacuum. I don't know if she hit him. I didn't hear a hit sound. Maybe she's not with some gas or something, whatever. And they're like, I thought you were on Nobunaga's side. And she's like, well, I am, but, you know, the laws of the troop are absolute, and we're not supposed to fight, right? So whatever winds up happening, they communicate back with the couple of members that are actually back, which is obviously the big guy. Forget his name now. It escapes me for the life of me. The big dude that winds up having the Franklin with the cool machine gun things from his fingers and the Nen bullets and Hisoka and whatnot. And there's a few of them left back there. And what winds up happening, and I thought this was great, is we got Pekinoda's on her way, right, to go and meet up with, we assume, Kurapika and everything. This is airport at 8 o'clock, something like that. You know, everything's coming to a head. But what's cool, the end of the episode is Hisoka, right? Hisoka's sitting there, and he's getting the lowdown on what's going on, and he's like, man. He's like, well, if we wind up leaving here and the 10 of us aren't here, Krollo will get killed, but I want to go to kill him so bad, right? So he goes and shoots a text out to his buddy or gives a call or whatever he does. Yeah, I think he shoots a text out and sends it. And then all of a sudden you see standing up on top of a building, just all cool, because that's what assassins do, right, is a Lumi. And he's like, yeah, I know you a little better than Krollo, because he was hired by Krollo, obviously, to take out the Dons, but he likes Hisoka better and knows him a little better. So he's like, yeah, that's cool. I'll work with you. So they got some kind of plan going on now. We got a Lumi's bad, because we know any of the Zoldyks are some bad motherfuckers, right? We know Hisoka's a badass, right? And he can take some people out. Gon and Killua almost got the drop on a couple of the members in the dark. So I don't know. Maybe together they can be, you know, put down for one or two. I don't know. Kurapika, we know, has got some great strength, obviously, with the chain jail. And, oh, man, it is so good. It's going down, and it's going to all culminate and wrap up, hopefully, at least a lot of it, in the next episode. And I just cannot wait to see who squares off against who. Who winds up walking out of this alive or dead or what have you, man. Just so awesome. My episode question for you, though, brothers and sisters, is What did you think? What were your thoughts on the plan that Kurapika, Melody, and Leorio wound up actually, you know, enacting and putting forth, all with very little communication to Gon and Killua about what they were going to do to actually take Krollo? Do you think that it was the right call to take Krollo, or do you think they should have tried to go and free the prisoners or the hostages or whatever? Let me know what your thoughts are. Let's get some conversation going in the comments down below. Feel free to hit the thumbs up, the like button if you should think that I deserve it, and subscribe if you haven't done so already. Shame on you if you haven't. We're going to look forward to catching all of you in the next one, Nation.
Remember to follow me on my other channels as well as Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram, too.